Morning. Can I welcome everybody to our first meeting of Session 6 of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. My name is Sarah Boyack. I'm Member of the Scottish Parliament for Lothian, and as the oldest member of the committee, I have the pleasure of convening this meeting for the first two items of business. So I'd first of all like to welcome all our members on this committee. Very much look forward to working with everyone. But before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind everybody, if you've got your mobile phone with you, can you turn it to silent? First agenda is item one, and that's declarations of interests. And this is the chance for everyone on the committee to declare any interests that they have that are relevant to the work of the committee. And I need to start off by saying that I don't have any relevant interests I wish to declare this morning. But can I go round the committee and get everyone to confirm if they have any registers of interest they want to put on the record? Can I first turn to Claire Adamson, MSP?
Thank you very much, Ed, convener. I have no relevant interest to declare this morning.
Thanks, Claire. Alistair Allen, you're next.
Thank you, convener. I have nothing particular to report, but refer people to my register of interest.
Thanks, Alistair. Donald Cameron?
Thank you, convener. I have no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you. Patrick Harvey?
Thank you. I don't think there are any registered interests that I'm required to declare, but I'd like to draw members' attention to the voluntary section of the entry, which shows I'm an associate member of the National Union of Journalists. And since joining this committee, I've also asked for an addition to the voluntary section to show that I'm a vice president of the European Movement in Scotland.
That's actually a very good opportunity for me, Patrick, to say that I'm also one of the vice presidents of the European Movement in Scotland. That's also on my voluntary register of interest. Thanks for that reminder there. Jenny Minto, you're next.
Thank you, convener. I have no relevant interest to declare. However, I would refer people to my register of interest and specifically my voluntary commitment that I am a trustee of a museum.
Thanks, Jenny. And Sue Webber.
Thanks, convener. I have no relevant interest to declare.
Right, that's great. Can I thank everybody for that? And just for the record, you can see all of our records of interest and our voluntary records on everybody's link on the Scottish Parliament's website, if people watching this broadcast are interested. Can I move now to agenda item two, which is the choice of convener. And our key task is to choose a convener. And the Parliament's agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as convener of our committee. And my understanding is that Claire Adamson, MSP, is that party's nominee. Does any member disagree with this nomination? And if you do, could you just type N in our chat bar now? I am delighted to say, Claire, that nobody has put N in the chat bar. So that means that nobody disagrees with your nomination. So can I congratulate Claire on her appointment and hand over the meeting to you to chair the rest of our meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Boyack, for chairing those first two agenda items, and thank you to the committee. I'm absolutely delighted to be made convener today and really looking forward to working with you going forward. The next agenda item, lost my place in the convener's brief there. Yeah. The next agenda item is the committee to choose a deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of this committee. I understand that Mr Cameron, MSP, is the party's nominee. Does any member disagree with this nomination? If so, if they could please put an N in the chat bar now. I don't see anything in the chat bar, so I'm absolutely delighted to congratulate Donald Cameron on his appointment as deputy convener. The extent of our remit is very challenging, and at times I think we may have different opinions, but I hope that we will really work well constructively together and consensually, if not all of the time, then most of the time in this committee. And thank you very much for your endorsement of both convener and deputy convener this morning. Our next agenda item is the legacy papers. We now turn to the session 5 legacy papers relevant to this committee, which are from the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs Committee and the Session 5 Finance Constitution Committee for legacy papers. Members have been provided with a helpful summary of the legacy papers ahead of the meeting. It would be helpful to have a short discussion on issues raised in the papers and any priorities that the members would like to the clerking team to maybe take forward to what will be a business planning session for the committee and our work programme at the end of August. If members would like to comment, could they put an R in the chat? And as a deputy convener, if I could invite Mr Cameron to perhaps start off this conversation.
Thank you very much, convener. And firstly, can I congratulate you on your appointment as our convener, and also say that I'm delighted to be the deputy convener of this committee in what should be a fascinating term of parliament. In terms of comments on the legacy papers, I will speak very broadly and hopefully briefly, because I think that's the real purpose of this agenda item. If I could start with culture, I think arts funding for me is going to be a very important aspect of the work of this committee, especially in the wake of the pandemic. And I was briefly on the Culture Committee in the last session of the Parliament where this was covered, but I think the state of funding of the arts is going to be absolutely pivotal for arts organisations in the next few years as we seek to recover from COVID. And I'm especially interested in exploring the kind of relationship between central funding of arts and also local funding of more community-based arts groups. Turning to Europe, clearly the UK's relationship with the EU in the wake of Brexit and the TCA, as well as the sort of overarching role I think this committee can play in terms of how the next few years go. I should say, in my view, I don't think it should be the purpose of this committee to really investigate specific aspects of policy such as trade or agriculture or the environment or health, which fall within the remit of subject committees. I think our role as a committee should probably be slightly more kind of overarching, as I say. But there are clearly important issues such as the Northern Ireland Protocol, which I think the legacy paper mentions as being really quite an urgent matter, and it's clearly very topical. Beyond that, devolution in general, I think the workings of the devolved settlement will require our scrutiny, not just in terms of Brexit and common frameworks, but also more generally. I was very interested in what the legacy paper said about interparliamentary working, and it would be my strong view, I think, that we energise that as a process in terms of the role of this committee and our relations with similar committees, both in the UK Parliament, but in other parliaments across the UK and also more widely. And finally, convener, in terms of international focus, the title of external affairs, I think, is important. I think whilst Europe will necessarily dominate discussions, I think it's important to note that we have a more wider international focus than purely the European Union, and in terms of Scotland's relationships with the rest of the world more generally. And I was struck by the comment about international development that was made in the legacy paper. I think that's quite an interesting aspect of policy that we could look at. But that's all I have to say at the moment. And thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Mr Cameron. I see a number of members have indicated they'd like to contribute. Please put an R in the chat if you wish to do so, and I'll bring in Ms Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think the first thing I wanted to say is that I think we've got two excellent legacy papers that are going to be really useful to us. I thought the one from the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs Committee is really good. There's a lot of recommendations, but bringing the two together, from my perspective, I think it's what we can do to add quality in terms of scrutiny from the Parliament's perspective. So in terms of the issue about Brexit, I think there's clearly issues that we need to think through. And Donald's right, there'll be other committees will be interested as well in things like Erasmus Plus and trade. But I think there's the wider issues of what happens post-Brexit and our work in terms of looking at the devolution settlement and how it's working, and picking up those overarching issues, as Donald referred to. I would be interested in the recommendations about scrutinising the Scottish Government in terms of the external affairs and international development work that they do, both in terms of the external affairs strategy, but also in terms of the international development programme. And I think both of those are going to be really important post-COVID. As the world begins to reopen again, I think what's our role in Scotland? And I think that's a really important issue for us. And I think the point about common frameworks and interparliamentary work are really important. I think that's a key issue for us to promote as a committee. And it's partly about our relationship in terms of the devolution settlement, but it's also about the post-Brexit relationships across the UK. I think that's a really important piece of work for us. On culture, for me, there's a huge agenda here in terms of post-COVID. We had the First Minister's statement yesterday about the beginnings of reopening for us in Edinburgh, and the Lothians of Festivals is a huge issue for us. But it takes you to culture, the capacity of theatres, music venues, live music venues to come back post-pandemic. And there's the impact of arts funding, which is both pre-COVID, but it's also what happens going forward to regenerate that sector. And I think, I suspect I'm not alone, but the contact I've had from artists, musicians, those involved in the culture sector, people that don't work full time, that have basically had no work at all during COVID, I think there's a lot of issues to pick up there. And my final point is, I wonder if it'd be helpful for us to get an update. We've got the Legacy Expert Panels report. I wonder for our first session whether it's useful getting an update from them, just to help shape our work, because there is such a lot in our brief. And I think accessing that expert report, it's about 6 months on since they did the report. I think that'd be quite useful for an update. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Ms. Moyack. Bring in Mr. Harvey.
Thank you very much, Convener, and like others, congratulations to yourself and Donald Cameron for your appointments. I think this committee does have a really interesting mix of topics, and although there will, as you said at the outset, be some within our remit which are clearly partisan and might result in some slightly more polarised debates, I'd like to think that there's more aspects of our remit where we might find that we're on the same page. The constitutional side, first of all, obviously there is a possibility, some would think a likelihood, that we'll have a bill referred to us on a referendum. But given that the framework legislation for referendums has already been passed, the bill itself is likely to be fairly simple and technical in a way. The debate around constitutional issues is much deeper and more complex. So I think we might give some thought to how we might separate out, having a debate on what might be a fairly straightforward bill in legislative terms from the much richer debate on constitutional questions. I very much agree with Donald's comment about inter-parliamentary working. I think there's even aside from constitutional debates in recent years, there's always been much more of an opportunity to do interparliamentary work than has ever been realised, not just with the UK Parliament, but others as well. and also scrutiny of and challenge to the intergovernmental machinery, which I think even many at UK level would recognise is pretty dysfunctional at the moment and needs to be examined. There are some constitutional issues which will be cross-committee as well. Issues like the fiscal framework, which will involve constitutional view as well as issues for the Finance Committee, issues around immigration and housing, issues even around health, where, for example, there are proposals in several party manifestos from the Holyrood election relating to the regulation of health professions, and there are devolved and reserved aspects of that. So there may be a number of issues which are perhaps slightly lower down the list of priorities for the committee, but where a bit of an interaction. On Europe, obviously, as people have said, the impact of Brexit, the issue of common frameworks, and especially in relation to common frameworks, parliamentary accountability. How do decisions that are effectively being signed off between governments get held to account in parliamentary terms, either here or at UK level? That's, I think, a really big unanswered constitutional question about our current constitutional status. The point was made about relationships within the UK and between the different parts of the UK. I think the same point should be made about Europe. Without the previous role of the former Europe committees, when we were a member of the European Union, in terms of engaging with the European legislative process, we, I think, now have a responsibility to maintain strong and active relationships at European level. That's going to be important for Scotland for the long term. And finally, on culture, I'm really glad that everybody who's spoken has talked about the importance of not losing sight of this. Culture, I think, has moved from different committee portfolios every session of the Scottish Parliament. I think I'm right in saying it's kind of shuffled around between different committee remits at every new session, and I think that's regrettable. I'd be really keen that we don't see those issues fall off of our radar. As Donald said, the impact of COVID and the potential for looking at COVID recovery in a way that benefits what we call the cultural scene. I think we have a tradition, I think, of talking about the creative industries, which is relevant and important, but creativity and creative opportunities for people to be involved in and have access to creativity and culture goes beyond what is formal creative industries, I think. So it relates to arts funding, of people, as people have talked about, but it relates to much more than just that. And in particular, the work that the last committee did, the last Europe External Affairs Tourism and Culture Committee did on the screen sector is going to be really important. This is something which used to be really significant in Scotland, has had a long-term decline, but has a real opportunity to rebuild and become much more significant. And in that regard, I know that you're already aware, Convener, that I've flagged up the issue of BBC Studios in Glasgow and potential changes that are being proposed there by the BBC at a UK level, and it's unclear whether BBC Scotland will be in a position to make a decision for itself about that. And the suggestion that a decision may even be made next month, which would not allow this committee the opportunity to scrutinise that question. So I've suggested that we write in the first instance to the BBC, both the BBC Scotland and copying in the Director General at UK level, asking that this be considered and that some caution be exercised, and that we have the opportunity to take evidence before a decision is reached. So I hope. That's a bit of an overview, but I hope members of the committee will be happy to support writing a letter along those lines. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. I'll go to Mr. Allen next.
Hi, thank you very much, Convener. Congratulations both to you and the new Deputy Convener as well. I think Patrick in particular has covered some of the constitutional issues there. We're obviously going to have to look at a referendum bill. I think on the point, again, Patrick's just made there about intergovernmental relations, as someone who's served or endured being on a joint ministerial committee, I think this committee, regardless of our differing perspectives on the Constitution, has to own up to the fact that that is not an effective mechanism for conversation between our governments, and start to look at perhaps what the alternatives might be in our view, or if we can come to any kind of consensus about that. I think the Brexit legacy is obviously something we're going to look at, and implications for the devolution settlement, implications for questions in the wake of Brexit around things like UK spending and what might have been considered devolved areas in the past, trade deals. I think Donald made a good point about having to be careful that we don't tread too far into the work of other committees, but I suppose there's a number of things in our remit and in the legacy papers that probably will involve us having to find some kind of modus vivendi with the other committees. It's difficult to see how we can talk about culture without talking about the place of culture in schools. It's difficult to see how we can talk about Brexit without talking about agriculture. So I think there's a bit of work to be done before we get started in how we establish good relations with other committees to make sure that we can do some of that. On international development, again, it's an area that I've been involved with in the past, I suppose, as well as scrutinising what the Scottish Government is doing on international development. That all has to be seen, not just in the context of COVID, but in the context, wider context of political swirly on, but a UK government which seems to be withdrawing from some of its commitments in the international development area as well. And that has an implication on the setting Scotland's relatively modest but important international development work finds itself. And in international development as well, I think there's specifically a job of work to be done in not just celebrating, but looking at our relationship as well with Malawi, since there's such a particular relationship.
Thank you very much, Ms. Minto, and finally, Ms. Minto first, please.
Great. Thank you, Claire, and congratulations on your convenorship, and also congratulations, Donald, too. I'm a new MSP, so new to the committee structures, but would like to reflect exactly what Patrick said. I think this is probably the most exciting committee that there is, and it's hugely wide-ranging. And I think the mix of MSPs on this, all bringing different experiences, whether within the Parliament or out with the Parliament, I think is really going to add to the work that we can do. I won't repeat what other people have said, but clearly leaving the EU and how we move forward from this is going to be a big part of our work, and reflecting on the relationships that we have across parliaments, as Patrick said, not just only Westminster, but also the European Parliament as well, and the other devolved nations. I think that's really important, given that the Scottish Government has made a commitment to keep pace with EU law. I wonder as well how we work with other committees, and so as well as the relationships across parliaments, I think we have to have strong relationships across the committees within our own parliament. My background is very mixed, but I have experience of working in broadcasting and also the arts, and like others have mentioned, the impact of COVID on these industries and the creativity of people that work in these areas has been very badly impacted. And I think not only do we have to worry about how it's impacted in the city's settings, we also have to think about the impact that it's had on rural areas and the likes of festivals or art shows, and that including our Indigenous languages as well. As I said, broadcasting, interesting that Patrick brought up the letter about the structures within BBC Scotland, and whether there's further work that needs to be done around commissioning of output and also the various channels that we have. So I'll finish there, but I'm very excited to be part of this committee and looking forward to working with experts across the various fields and learning more about and helping shape our future.
Thank you. And finally, Ms. Weber.
Thanks, Claire, and congratulations on your convenorship for this committee. I suppose I'm new, like Jenny, to this Parliament and new to the committee, but it is quite a broad-reaching remit, and I think, like the other members have mentioned, it's really key that we don't step on people's toes on that subject committees, but there is definitely somewhere for us to dip in and out as and when necessary, and it's finding that degree and that balance of influence, and it's going to be key for us to be a really effective committee. So I'd like to, that'll be interesting to see how that develops. In terms of, again, like Sarah, I'm a Lothian List MSP, and so the festival and the culture side of things is really important to me. How the festivals and everything that comes around that Edinburgh economy changes post-COVID and how it adapts is going to be key, but it's also a sector that's been widely left with and unsupported in the last 15, 16 months, so we need to be very aware of that as well. Focusing also on in that sort of the four points that were brought out in the legacy paper, the bit about the census 2022, I think that's something that we really have to make sure we're on top of. I was, as a citizen, very disappointed that we didn't take part in that UK-wide census in 2021. So it's really key that we figure out how we get back on track with the rest of the country and make sure that census is carried out. It is, does take place. There's no excuses for that to not take place anymore. I also remember all the emotion that we had when we saw the fire at the Glasgow School of Art. I think it must. It was very upsetting. It was. We must make sure there's an investigation into that and see what's happened, because that was a great cultural travesty for the country. And then finally, on that inter-parliamentary working, I think again, from being an outsider for longer than perhaps some of the members here, people that are in our country don't want to see us bickering between the different parliaments in the UK. They want to see us working together in a much more positive frame. And I think if that's one thing we take away from this, is we have to start working in a much more positive way and finding positive things to work on rather than always drilling down on the minuscule negatives, because people don't want to see that. There is time for that, but we have to be mindful about what we're doing, we're here to do. So that's my part. So thank you very much, convener.
Thank you, and thank you to everyone for some really interesting points there. I'm really glad that the importance of inter-parliamentary working came to the fore for most of you today. It was something that I was very conscious that we need to be working very hard on going forward. So I'm delighted that there's consensus in building those relationships across the UK and in the wider context as well. I was reflecting on Patrick's comments about culture. I think maybe the legacy paper from the Education Culture Committee that I sat on for a long time was instrumental in culture being moved away from education and into Europe, which I thought was a better fit for it. But that being said, the issue of crossover work, Alistair and I then sat on an education committee that had a substantive bit of work on music tuition in schools and covering the cultural aspects of that. So I think that this committee, as such as the Europe committee, it's not so much the finance committee aspects, but the Europe committee, it has always had that overreaching and cross-parliamentary responsibility, if you like. And I think that's worked well in the past. I think the conveners have been able to work collectively together through conveners group and with the clerks working to ensure that there isn't a conflict between the other committees. And I'd be very, very keen to ensure that that happens going forward. I was also very taken that when we do culture, we sometimes concentrate on the big ticket items and the major festivals and the larger organisations and the bigger funded organisations. But to hear that culture and the community is of interest, I think to both Ms. Minto and Ms. Boyack as well mentioned that. So that's something I'm very keen to investigate as well. And I think pulling together some of the strands, I think we've a very definite role to play in just how devolution now works in a prospects at Worlds, because we were established as a parliament in a very different constitutional context, and really we may have a role in actually looking at fit for purpose operations of the Scottish Parliament and those some of those relations in a post-Brexit world as we go forward. So I think some really interesting issues to take forward. Patrick, thank you so much for bringing to our attention the BBC situation. I understand all members have had an opportunity to view a draft letter. Look into the chat again. If anyone's not happy with that letter going out, could they put an N in the chat now? I'm not saying that, so that's agreed that that letter, as drafted by the clerks, will go to the BBC. I also minded this morning that there's been an announcement on the possible privatisation of Channel 4, which of course will have an impact and a footprint in Scotland as well. So that's something absolutely immediately that has come to the fore that we might be wanting to do, have a look at as well. So I think we've given the clerks enough to think about, and I really look forward to coming back in August for a work programme meeting. That'll be probably a full day of discussion, a full day of proposals. We may well have an indication of the government programme and likely bills that might come to this committee going forward, and but I think on that note we've got enough to be going on with just now, and it concludes our business for today. And thank you everyone for their attendance. I'm really looking forward, as everyone said, very exciting opportunity in this committee to do some really good work. So thank you once again. And that ends the committee for today. Thank you.